Night's item of business is a debate on motion 23963 in the name of Andy Whiteman on the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporation Scotland Bill at stage one. Can I ask those members who wish to take part to press the R, press to speak in the chat function, and I call on Andy Whiteman to speak to and move the motion. Mr. Whiteman, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name. I'm delighted to be opening this stage one debate on the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporation in Scotland Bill. I want to first of all thank all those who have contributed to this bill's development, including all who responded to the call for views on the draft proposal and all those who gave evidence as part of stage one scrutiny. I also want to thank the Local Government and Communities Committee for its diligent work and support. I owe particular thanks to COSLA for their support. Scotland's councils have been calling for incorporation of the Charter for a very long time. And I also want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for her constructive engagement and support for the bill. Finally, and most of all, I want to thank the Parliament's non-governmental and non-government bills unit for their hard work and support. And I'm very grateful also to Christine O'Neill QC for drafting a bill that's withstood quite intense legal scrutiny. Presiding Officer, the purpose of this bill is to strengthen the standing of local government in Scotland as part of Scotland's democratic architecture. In my opinion, this is a vital endeavour. Since 1975, when Scotland abolished genuine local government with the scrapping of town councils, local authorities' standing and powers have slowly but steadily weakened. And in a paper published in 2013, COSLA wrote, and I quote, "Local democracy is weak compared to Europe. Scotland is one of the most centralised countries in Europe. It is no coincidence that our European neighbours are often more successful at improving outcomes and have much greater turnout at elections. We cannot hope to emulate the success of these countries without acknowledging that they have more local councils, local elected councillors representing fewer people, and that these councils and their services are constitutionally protected and their funding secured by law, even with regard to national policy making. We should seek the same benefit and the same independence that local government has in most Western democracies," end quote. Now, the means by which this bill strengthens local government is by incorporating the European Charter of Local Self-Government into Scots law. The Charter is an international treaty of the Council of Europe, opened for signature in 1985. Its substantive articles set out in the schedule to the bill and guarantee a set of basic freedoms and protections for local government across the 47 member states of the Council of Europe. The treaty was signed by the United Kingdom by the then newly elected Labour government in June 1997 and entered into force on the 1st of August 1998. However, the Charter can have no legal force in domestic law until it is incorporated into domestic law. And so, at its heart, the bill achieves this incorporation in Section 2 by placing a legal duty on Scottish ministers to act compatibly with the Charter as reproduced in the schedule. If this bill is enacted, then the Charter articles will become law. They can be relied on in the Scottish courts, and legal remedies can be sought for any alleged violations of them. For example, the bill allows a declaration of incompatibility to be made or secondary legislation to be struck down where the Section 2 duty has been breached. And I want to emphasise that the bill is not designed to encourage legal challenges. It is not a sanctions-driven bill. The aim of this legislation is to develop a culture of compliance with the Charter. And two sections of the bill are designed to that specific end. Section 3 obliges ministers to report at least every 5 years on steps they have taken to safeguard local self-government. And Section 8 places a duty on members introducing public bills to Parliament to state the extent to which, in their view, such legislation is compatible with the Charter articles. Presiding Officer, I want to turn now to the Stage 1 report from the Local Government and Communities Committee. I welcome the committee's support for the bill, and I welcome its focus on analysing the legal and practical implications of the bill. As the Faculty of Advocates noted, the bill cannot entrench the Charter as some form of constitutional protection for local government in a country with no written constitution. And if the bill is enacted, it would provide a check and a challenge function only for so long as it remained law and was not amended or repealed. And that's a reality that affects any such bill under the UK Constitution, most particularly the other bill that's currently before Parliament incorporating international law, namely the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child Incorporation Scotland Bill. Now, in practical terms, the committee is right to note uncertainty as to the legal reach of the Charter. Time will tell on that front. Some debate was had in committee as to whether the bill merely sent a message or had far-reaching implications. In my view, the bill does indeed send a message, a very important political message, but also a substantive legal effect, making compliance with the Charter a matter that can now be referred to a court for a ruling where there is a dispute as to whether legislation is compliant or not. Presiding Officer, I want briefly to mention amendments that I would propose to lodge should the bill pass tonight at stage one. The first and most substantive relates to a recommendation made by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee in relation to the power in Section 6 for ministers to take remedial action in consequence of a declaration of incompatibility by the courts. This is a significant power to delegate to ministers, and the question is whether its use could be constrained in some way. Now, having reflected on this question, I can confirm that it would be my intention to lodge amendments to attach a super affirmative procedure to the use of this power to provide the level of scrutiny required. I'd also bring forward amendments to confirm that no criminal offences can be created or amended by the use of this power, and I will also reflect further on some technical wording that's been drawn to my attention. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, the United Kingdom is one of six member states of the Council of Europe not to have given the Charter any legal effect in its domestic law. The Scottish Constitutional Convention recommended back in 1998 that the Parliament should embody the principles contained in the Charter, in particular a principle of general competence. In October 2019, a report by the Consultative Steering Group on the Scottish Parliament reviewing 20 years of devolution noted the ongoing failure to achieve this. This bill addresses that long-standing concern, and I hope members will support it this afternoon. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whiteman. Can I again remind members that if you want to take part in the debate, you have to press R in the chat function. I now call on James Dornan to speak on behalf of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Convener, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to speak as Convener of the Local Government and Communities Committee in support of this bill brought forward by Andy Whiteman, our colleague on the committee. The comments that follow reflect a collective view of the committee who, minus Andy, considered the bill at stage one. But before I go on to that, I'd like to thank my fellow committee members, all the witnesses who took the time to give evidence, and as always, our magnificent clerking team. We held a call for views over the summer, receiving 22 responses. These included some well-informed responses from local government, academia, legal experts, among others. As members have heard, the central aim of the bill is to give the European Charter of Local Self-Government a degree of direct effect in our domestic law. The UK is already a signatory to the Charter under international law, and the Scottish Government told us it considers itself bound by the Charter and, in its view, abides by it. The main question this committee grappled with at stage one was therefore, what will this bill actually do? Will it have much effect on local governance at all? A key consideration for the committee at stage one has been attempting to gauge just how much of an impact the bill would have. We've not found this straightforward. Some evidence has been to the effect that the bill is somewhat technical or has referred to the symbolic value of passing or indeed not passing it. The prospect of the bill having much financial impact, either in councils or in central government, or of it leading to a step change in the way councils work and provide services, has been doubted. The Scottish Government itself has said that it was already bound to adhere to the principles set out in the bill. Solar's representative told the committee there was a danger that we exaggerate what the bill will actually do. And yet, at the same time, many stakeholders viewed the bill as important, necessary, and even potentially transformative in terms of the constitutional and working relationship between the state and local government. Some evidence sought to reconcile these two positions by arguing that the bill would be more of a prompt, an enabler of good practice and good partnership working rather than a disruptive game changer. Requirements in the bill, such as a requirement for a legislative statement and compatibility, would reduce the risk of future laws or policies being in conflict with the Charter articles. What is it? If the answer is yes, then will the bill be an agent of positive change, or could it have unpredictable, even disruptive effects? We might compare the bill with the Human Rights Act 1998. Now, no one is arguing that this bill ranks equally with the 98 Act in terms of likely impact. There are some similarities in what you might call their basic architecture. Both are also alike in that they incorporate into domestic law a set of principles that are wide-ranging, declaratory, and somewhat open-ended in the language used. Generation on from the 98 Act, I think most here would agree that its impact has been resoundingly positive, but it's thrown up some surprises along the way as it's been tested in the courts, surprises that have occasionally been challenging and even costly. The 98 Act has also rebalanced power away from the executive and towards the judiciary, giving them a greater say in determining whether government acts or omissions are lawful. None of this is necessarily bad in itself, but it is a change, and there is arguably the potential for this bill to do the same. The conclusion that the committee has come to is that we should welcome the incorporation of the Charter into Scots law, but you might call this a guarded welcome, because as both the Faculty of Advocates and the Law Society noted, the full legal reach of the bill is uncertain. If the Parliament agrees to this bill, it should do so with open eyes, alert to the possibility of future cases testing the legal meaning of particular provisions in the Charter. This could include cases touching on policy or even funding issues in relation to local government that have not usually been the province of the court before now. However, there are two important matters which help reassure us. First, incorporating the Charter into domestic law brings us into the European main. Most of our neighbours have been down this route, and the sky has not yet fallen in. Quite the contrary. The general view is that it has helped foster a healthier working relationship between central and local government. There was some evidence, for instance, that it had made central governments reassess the way they consulted councils before making important changes. The evidence from Europe, therefore, is that incorporating the Charter into domestic law is more an act of evolution than revolution. Secondly, no one we heard from at stage one thought that the bill was likely to mean a rush to the courts. Local government witnesses themselves were unanimously clear that the legal route would be a last resort, a nuclear option, as one put it, that everyone would be at pains to avoid. The value that witnesses saw in the incorporation of the Charter was as a backstop. It would enshrine a set of good government principles in our law, and in so doing, help level up the working relationship between central and local government. Put it differently, Scotl and others in local government felt that giving the Charter effect in domestic law would help keep the Scottish Government, and any future Scottish Government, on its toes. That too became the committee's view and summarises why we think this bill is worth the Parliament's support. Presiding Officer, I'll conclude by noting that Mr Whiteman and the Scottish Government agree that some amendments would be needed if this bill was to pass. If there's a clear message from the principles today, the Parliament today, that it agrees to the general principles, that's something the committee will obviously note in terms of any future Stage 2 scheduling at this late stage of the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I now call on Aileen Campbell to open for the government. Please.
Presiding Officer, did you introduce me? I didn't hear you.
I did introduce you, but I'm happy to do it. Cabinet Secretary, opening for the government, please.
Apologies, I think your sound cut out. However, nonetheless, we'll proceed. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to thank Andy Whiteman for bringing this bill forward and for steering it to this point. It's a testament to his long-standing commitment to this topic, and I'm happy to respond on behalf of the government today. I also want to thank the Local Government and Communities Committee for their thoughtful Stage 1 report, as well as the clerks who assisted in preparing it. And I would also like to thank those who gave evidence to the committee. That engagement, that expertise and that experience helped to shape a report and response from the committee that is really helpful to ensure that we progress this legislation effectively. And at the heart of it, this bill is about partnership and cooperation, and the current COVID-19 pandemic has shown us once again of the importance of collaboration, national and local government working together to respond to local circumstances in order to keep the most vulnerable in our society safe and essential services available. And I want to take the opportunity and every opportunity to thank local government workers across Scotland for the work that they have done and are continuing to do. It has been a remarkable effort. Developing and maintaining a close, constructive partnership between national and local government has always been a key priority of this government. and to give a sense of that partnership approach and to illustrate the influential role that local government already has, I want to point to some of the current areas of success and mechanisms in place for that joint working. For example, COSLA are co-signatories of the National Performance Framework, which sets out our shared ambitions for a successful and inclusive Scotland. Those principles underpinned by the shared values of kindness, dignity and respect. We also jointly launched the Local Governance Review as part of our shared commitment to subsidiarity and local democracy. And that creates, I believe, an exciting opportunity to promote what could be the biggest shift of power since devolution. We want to ensure decisions are taken as close as possible to those they affect most. We do want a vibrant and inclusive democracy that supports local self-determination. Mr. Whiteman's Members Bill, therefore, is welcome, as we hope it will create the conditions for further, more ambitious changes to how Scotland is governed. Ensuring local government's voice is heard and creating the conditions for meaningful engagement is firmly rooted in our policy development process. There are many examples across portfolios of government of how local government plays a significant and inclusive role in the current decision-making process and governance of Scotland. And despite the UK government's decision to delay their budget until March, we've given local government in Scotland as much notice as possible of their settlement to assist them with their planning and to provide them with security. Cabinet Secretary for Finance announced last week that we'll make available to local government a total funding package amounting to £11.6 billion for 2021-22, including a £245.6 million increase in core revenue funding and an additional £259 million of non-recurring COVID funding. And this is a total additional revenue funding of more than half a billion pounds. And we've also shown that we are committed to subsidiarity and local decision making. We have put forward ambitious legislation such as the Community Empowerment Act and the Islands Act with and signalled a significant transfer of power to communities across Scotland. The Historic Islands Scotland Act 2018 introduces the regulations which specifically enables relevant local authorities to request the transfer of responsibilities from Scottish ministers to them. It is my hope that this bill will reinforce the positive working relationship with local government. And I also know that the incorporation of the Charter into domestic law has been a long-held aspiration of COSLA, and our commitment to supporting the bill sends out a strong signal of the value that we place on local government. Now, we originally took a neutral position to Mr. Whiteman's bill to allow for full diligence to be carried out, and that's quite normal for a member's bill. We needed to fully understand its implications and its practical application. Now, there are some issues around the drafting, which I think some technical amendments would help to improve, but these are not substantial. And my officials have been engaging positively with Mr. Whiteman's team to discuss what that might involve. I hope that that collaborative approach to amendments that was achieved with the member in charge of the recent period poverty bill can be replicated here, and I think Parliament is better served because of that approach. However, I recognise that there can be challenges, and there are times that national government and local government will not always agree. So I welcome the position of local government colleagues in giving evidence to the committee when they said that they did not think that there would be much, if any, litigation that arises from the bill. The consistent message was that this bill will strengthen local democracy by ensuring a parity of esteem between the various spheres of government. But a key message from the committee report was also the legal uncertainty that the bill will introduce. Uncertainty in relation to how frequently it would give rise to litigation, uncertainty in how the courts would handle any future cases, and uncertainty in what they called the legal reach of the Charter, how far it might stray into areas that have so far been seen as belonging more to the policy sphere rather than the legal sphere. Going to court to resolve any issues should always be the last option, and certainly not the first option. I'm sure that we can all agree that unnecessary legal challenges would take up time and money that can be better used elsewhere. And indeed, Andy Whiteman himself, in his opening remarks, noted that it is not a sanctions-driven bill. So it is important that national and local government continue to properly discuss issues and understand their different perspectives. So if there's anything more that we can do to continue to strengthen the relationship, then of course my cabinet ministerial colleagues and I are always willing and open to discussing that and considering that. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to close by saying that we do, as a government, support the general principles of the bill. I've set out how we believe that we act to ensure that local government has a full voice and role within the decisions that we take, and that we want to continue to positively engage with local government, building on what is a strong platform of collaboration to cement our strong partnership and improve the lives of the people of Scotland. And it's my sincere hope that as the progress of this bill continues through Parliament, that this can further amplify that endeavour. So thank you, and I thank again the member for bringing it to this position.
Thank you, and I call Alexander Stewart to open for the Conservatives. Mr Stewart, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be able to take part in this afternoon's debate on the European Charter for Local Self-Government and open on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. I would like to thank Mr Whiteman, MSP, for bringing forward this bill. As someone who spent 18 years in local government myself as a councillor, I know the importance of local democracy. Local councillors and local residents know the best for their communities and for their areas. If we are truly believe the principle of localism, we should trust them to make more decisions for themselves and to have more influence over the budgets and incomes they have. But this is simply not the case, and it's not happening in Scotland. In fact, Scotland is one of the most centralised countries in the world when it comes to local decision making. And this position has got worse in recent years, and particularly under the current SNP government. Despite many of the arguments that we've made and we've heard, devolution has not brought power closer to our communities, quite the reverse. It has centralised more power here in Edinburgh. It is not local government. It is not local democracy. Our councillors are effectively neutered by diktats from Scottish Government, and this needs to change. So the proposals in this bill to incorporate the European Charter of Local Self-Government in Scots law is welcome. As has already been mentioned, these principles have already been accepted by the Scottish and UK governments, but Scotland is currently the only country in Europe where the articles have not yet been enshrined in law. Many of these principles are already adhered to, and not just in Scotland, but the rest of the UK. Even one of the most elected, we elect councillors to run our own councils. These councils have wards and boundaries which are dealt with by an independent boundary commission that carries out extensive consultation, and our councils are able to borrow for their capital investment. But there is also a number of areas where Scotland does not currently adhere to the articles of the Charter. To give two examples, firstly, the Charter states that councils should only be subject to supervision by a body such as the Scottish Government to ensure compliance with the law. This is not the case when it comes to planning. The Scottish Government routinely overturns decisions taken by democratically elected local councillors, with 4 in 10 council planning decisions overturned in appeal in the last year alone. The Scottish Conservatives would ban this practice, bringing it in line with the Charter. Secondly, the Charter states that councils should be free to decide how to spend their own money on what, as far as possible, the grants should be earmarked for specific proposals. Once again, this is not currently done in Scotland. In the evidence we heard from the convener of Shetland Council, he suggested that 3/5 of council revenue was ring-fenced for national outcomes, making it very difficult for councils to make a difference. This again would need to change to bring us in line with the Charter. It is very welcome that the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary have committed to supporting the bill. However, one of the responsibilities that we argue about is about the significant policy changes that would require to be put in place to ensure that the breach of the bill was not taking place. And if that was the case, we could see that happen and the day after the law was brought into place. In Section 6 of the bill, as proposed, does not give Scottish ministers quite extensive powers to make regulation. These indicate immunities and primary legislation and should be deemed that existing law is incompatible with provisions within the bill. Given the SNP's protracted record on localism, however, we must question whether it is simply committed to bringing the policies in line with articles of the Charter. There is a more fundamental question, however, about whether the bill will achieve its desired objectives. Section 5 enables the Court of Session or the UK Supreme Court to declare a provision of an act of subordinate legislation within the competency of the Parliament and the incorporation within the Charter itself. This is something that we need to see and may need to help and see further considerations at stage two. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I welcome this bill today and will support it at stage one. Far too long, the SNP government have treated local councils with contempt and undermined their democracy. We in the Scottish Conservatives value the principles of localism, and we want to do everything within our power to ensure that councils do have that localism objective. Putting all local government in Scotland onto the same legislative footprint as the rest of Europe is certainly a step in the right direction, and one that I very much welcome and support. But we also need to see a meaningful policy change for the Scottish Government if we are to truly meet the principles of the Charter of Local Self-Government. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Sarah Boyack to open for Labour. Ms Boyack, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted that we're discussing the incorporation of the European Charter for Local Self-Governance today. In 1997, the Labour Government signed up to the Charter and ratified it a year later. So I'm glad that we're here, more than two decades on, to put this Charter into Scottish law and to empower Scottish local government. As we've seen in the response to the pandemic, and has been said in the Chamber before, our councils have stepped up to the challenge, been capable of fundamental change in their service delivery, informed by the knowledge and experience they have of what local communities and businesses need, and have been able to deliver real, workable solutions during the pandemic. As a member of the Local Government and Communities Committee, I've worked with colleagues to scrutinise the bill and the intention behind it, and I want to thank all of the witnesses and those who've given us evidence and the support we've received from the Parliament's clerks. Since I returned to the Parliament in 2019, I've also been in a position to see just why this bill is so necessary in relation to my conversations with local government representatives. And Alexander Stewart referenced the written submission to the committee from the leader of Shetland Council. And in talking about the extent to which his budget is now focused on issues that he's working with the Scottish Government on, he's described the sense that they are now becoming very much like a health board. It shouldn't be like that. And I've also had feedback from councillor colleagues across the country who say that their autonomy as elected officials is being chipped away by centralised policy decisions. In introducing this bill, Andy Whiteman has aimed to create a parity of esteem between the Scottish Government and local government, and ensuring that decisions which impact locally are made locally. And that's a principle that I and my Labour local colleagues wholeheartedly support. The UK is the only one of the 47 member states of the Council of Europe which hadn't transposed this charter. And I think it's politically an important political statement for us supporting it today. Section 2 of this bill places a duty on Scottish ministers to act compatibly with the bill, and Section 4 places an obligation on this Parliament to pass legislation which is compatible with the Charter articles. And I think that's an important step, ensuring that the work of our elected representatives in the Chamber complement the work elected representatives in our councils are doing to support their local communities. I also believe that Section 8 of the bill is of great importance. It requires individual members bringing forward their members' bills to state whether, in their view, the bill is compatible with the Charter. So I believe that gives us the opportunity for members of the Parliament to work with our council colleagues and strengthen the impact of members' bills that come before the Parliament, make sure they're compliant and can be facilitated by councils in a way which understands local needs and aspirations. I want to conclude by noting that the squeeze on local authority resources has been exacerbated under this government. And despite voicing its support for initiatives like the Local Governance Review and for this bill, this year's budget is another disappointment for local government, which has seen their budgets lose £937 million in non-ring-fenced revenue expenditure since 2013-14. And as I said at the start, this pandemic has highlighted just how dependent we all are, our local communities are, on local government supporting us, and in the way that councils have shown us the myriad of ways that they can innovate to respond to crisis. In their response to the committee, COSLA stated that this bill would strengthen local and national government's ability to work jointly to improve outcomes in our communities across Scotland. This strengthens Scotland's democracy by ensuring that communities enjoy the same local democratic rights that are already commonplace across Europe and beyond. deliver the unfinished business of this Parliament by ensuring that for the first time, this partnership between national and local government is built into Scotland's system of democratic governance and reflected in its day-to-day culture and practice, and to ensure that Scotland fully complies with international treaty obligations and addresses outstanding issues that have previously been identified in this regard. I completely agree with COSLA. These are important principles, and I look forward, I hope, to Parliament passing this bill with cross-party support this afternoon and to addressing the detailed issues when it comes to committee. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Boyack. And I now call on John Finney for the Green Party, and at the same time, I hand over the chair to my colleague. Mr. Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating my friend and colleague Andy Whiteman in getting his worthy proposal to this point. I know the work that's involved with a member's bill, the commitment required, the team effort that's there. I had that with Stephen and my own team, and I know Andy had it in his team with Billy and Charlotte and Kieran. So we're here because of Andy Whiteman's forensic approach to all his work, and that's reflected in what we will discuss. It's about the principle of incorporation of the European Charter of Local Self-Government, which I hope will be agreed unanimously. And this is entirely in line with Mr. Whiteman's long-standing commitment to the principle of subsidiarity and the importance of local government, a vibrant local and, dare I say it, radical local democracy. We know from SPICE that this has been in place since 1985. All 47 members of the European Council are signatories, including the UK, since 1998. And I note from the briefing, it says it is expected that any new states to join the Council would sign the treaty. Now, it's perhaps not for today's debate, but we would have gotten there via an independent Scotland, but I welcome the opportunity Andy's Whiteman's given us to accelerate that process. And we also learn that the UK has a dualist legal system, domestic and international law, are distinct and separate from one another. And to give public international law the same legal authority as domestic law, it must be incorporated into domestic law. That will give the legal effect that can be key issues enforced by the Scottish courts. Now, the policy memorandum also confirms that it's paragraph 61 that the incorporation of the Charter, the reproducing of the principles wording goes into the bill, and that commits signatories to basic rules which seek to uphold the political, administrative and financial independence of local authorities through legislation. And other members have talked about the role of COSLA in this, and COSLA established a commission in 2013 that talked about identifying a roadmap to deliver the full benefit of a shift in power towards local democracy for people in Scotland. In a blog, Mr. Whiteman says, why does this matter? It goes on to say it's designed for constitutional protections for local government, and he outlines the reasons why these are absent, and they do relate to our structures. And if passed, and I hope it will, this will allow anyone to challenge an executive action of Scottish ministers or legislation passed by the Scottish Parliament if they believe that either is incompatible with the Charter, which being international law has primacy. So the courts would have powers to quash actions, and the bill gives teeth to that. But I note that the member also says, and the Cabinet Secretary refers to COSLA's position on this, this isn't about encouraging legal actions, rather it's about heightening awareness of the provisions of the Charter, ensuring compliance, putting a duty on Scottish ministers to promote. There is issues about centralisation, undoubtedly there is, and that's fundamentally about power struggles. Intentions have been alluded to about planning. And is local government independent if it's limited in its ability to raise finance? The implications of membership drops for the rural councils, ironically, as a result of the Islands Bill, is something that many in the Highlands and Islands find very frustrating. And if central government of all colours gives money and then determines the nature of the spend of that money, that's not an independent council. So, let's not pass the bill for the sake of it. Important, though that is, let's pass it because what it contributes to a vibrant local democracy and discussion thereon. So it's with pleasure that the Scottish Green Party will be supporting Mr. Whiteman's motion tonight in support of the bill. Thank you very much, Deputy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finney, and thank you also to my colleague Christine Graham for handing over. I call Alex Cole Hamilton to be followed by Keith Brown. Alex Cole Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to start by offering my thanks and the thanks of my party to Andy Whiteman for bringing forward this important bill to Parliament. It's a reminder of what an asset he is to our chamber. My party welcomes autonomy for our local authorities and efforts to increase our autonomy wherever we find it. And so, as such, we will be supporting this legislation today. Council have worked in lockstep with the Scottish and UK governments during this pandemic. Local authority staff have been critical to getting support to those who need it, and we're grateful to them for this. It's why the Scottish Liberal Democrats have repeatedly pressed the government to ensure money reaches the front line where it is needed. Before the pandemic struck, my party had spent years appealing to the Scottish Government to stop hollowing out local government and treating it with the contempt that it has done. It has handed councils disproportionate cuts year after year and stripped them of the power to do what is right for their area. In addition to their funding settlements being squeezed to a much greater degree than the Scottish Government's own budget, councils also found greater proportions of their budgets ring-fenced by ministers for their approved purposes. It has forced local authorities to cut services that people rely on and increase charges. It's so important that we allow our councils the financial freedom to plan their own budgets, tailoring plans to what the community needs locally. My party believe that, just like Holyrood, local councils should have the power to raise the majority of the money that they spend. We oppose the centralisation of services, and we've seen at the hands of this government, the police force is one example, and we oppose the SNP entrenching the broken council tax after they promised to scrap it. This is not the first time this charter has been discussed in this way at Holyrood. I'd like to briefly mention my former colleague Tavish Scott back in 2015 during the passage of the Community Empowerment Bill. Tavish put forward amendments at stage 2 and 3 to enshrine the principles of the charter in law. When he was proposing this, he said, "Devolution should not stop in this building. Rather, we should ensure that local government and those who serve communities, representing all political parties and none, have the ability to use the power of general competence in the most sensible and constructive way for the people whom they serve." Sadly, neither of those amendments were agreed at the time. That's despite support from key stakeholders, including COSLA. However, I am glad to see that we now have the opportunity to make the powers of our local authorities crystal clear to ensure their autonomy. The 10 principles of this charter were ratified by all 47 member states of the European Council in 1998, and we should take notice of this unanimous endorsement. If passed in future, all bills introduced here will have to be checked for compatibility with the charter, and I welcome this all-encompassing approach. Protection for local decision making is key, along with financial freedom. The Scottish Liberal Democrats will always stand up for local government, and these benches will be supporting this bill tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cole Hamilton. I call Keith Brown to be followed by Alison Harris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I come to this debate with the benefit most recently of being a member of the Local Government Communities Committee, which has held 3 meetings to hear and consider evidence from a range of bodies on the issues covered by the bill. I'd also wish to draw upon my experience working as a local government officer for nearly 2 decades, a councillor for 11 years, and a member of the European Committee of the Regions for 6 years. Indeed, I can recall supporting incorporation of the treaty into Scots law at COSLA more than 20 years ago as a council leader. I think it's unfortunate that the contributions from the Conservative and Liberal Democrat parties, of course coalition partners, has been to change this debate into one as an anti-SNP rant. And in particular, Mr. Stewart's contribution, the idea during my time in local government from the 1980s that anybody sees the Conservatives or latterly the Liberal Democrats as a friend of local government is just laughable. But I would like to start by congratulating Mr. Whiteman on bringing this Members' Bill to a Stage 1 debate in the Chamber. As has been said, the Bill seeks to incorporate into Scots law the European Charter of Local Self-Government, a treaty of the Council of Europe that was adopted in 1985, ratified by the UK in 1998, before even this Parliament was established. The Council of Europe, of course, is one European institution of which the UK remains a member, despite Brexit. And yet, once again, the UK remains typically out of step with the rest of Europe, with the UK and Hungary the only 2 countries out of 47 not to have incorporated Charter into the domestic legal framework. I'm conscious, Presiding Officer, that there's been about 4 different computations of how many countries have signed up. We'll have to get that right when we get to Stage 2. But the, certainly the UK's position undermines any claim that they make, and as was put forward by Alexander Stewart, to be supporters of what they would call true devolution for local authorities. Fortunately, in this, if not in other spheres, we in Scotland have the power in our own hands to resist being dragged away from the European mainstream by the Europhobes of Whitehall. Yes, the treaty was ratified in 1998, but ratification does not make law. As the Law Society point out in its submission, and as the explanatory notes of the bill also make clear, in the legal systems of the UK, domestic and international law are distinct and separate from one another. They agree that to give public international law the same legal authority as domestic law, it must be incorporated into domestic law. The committee received submissions from a range of interested individuals and organisations, and not one of those submissions opposed incorporation of the Charter, with most, including bodies such as COSLA and the Society of Local Authority Lawyers and Administrators, clearly supporting the case for incorporation. COSLA said, "It would strengthen Scotland's democracy by ensuring that communities enjoy the same local democratic rights that are already commonplace across Europe and beyond." They also say that incorporation would strengthen local and national government's ability to work jointly to improve outcomes in communities across Scotland. That is something we've seen across the country over the last year, and I think this should be an appropriate point to reflect on the huge effort that's been put in by local council staff, officers and elected members of all different parties across the whole of Scotland and across the course of the pandemic. In so many situations, they've been in the front line, delivering help, support and advice, which the people and communities we represent have needed. As we discussed this bill in committee, it was clear there were concerns that the bill would not make a difference, and that it could instead be a charter for endless and expensive legal disputes between different partners in government. I expect and I hope that it will not. But for those that said that they wanted it to establish a real parity of esteem between different arms of government, I would say I share in that hope, but I think what's much more likely to achieve that is the fantastic role that our local authorities have played in this pandemic, providing absolutely vital local services to people. And I support this bill's progress to the next stage of the process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. Can I call Alison Harris to be followed by David Torrance?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The debate about autonomy for local authorities in Scotland has gone on for some time in the Scottish Parliament. Parties from most sides of this chamber have, at various points and from various perspectives, made the case for councils to have more power. Unfortunately, the only party that seems resistant to this is the one which has sat in government since 2007. In that time, we have seen a complete failure to deliver more control to town councils, to town halls, and councils have had their funding cut to the bone in the process. You could argue things are getting worse. Just last month, the Scottish Conservatives revealed that 36% of the planning decisions which were made by councils but then appealed by applicants were overturned. That tells you everything you need to know about this Scottish Government's commitment to local decision-making. It's galling for local people to see their council go through a careful planning process where residents and community councils make their feelings known, the developers are allowed to properly plead their case, and a group of locally accountable members, often from a coalition of more than one political party, reach a measured decision. But then that is all swept aside when the developers go over the heads of the council to a Scottish Government in Edinburgh who, in one in every three instances, rides over the top of the local decision and sides with the controversial development in question. The people said no, the community group said no, the council said no, yet still the Scottish Government waved these plans through regardless. These are major developments which affect people's everyday life, like wind farms, large housing developments and controversial infrastructure and redevelopment proposals. So it's clear that something needs to be done about this, and incorporating the European Charter of Local Self-Government into Scots law would at least go some way to strengthening the hand of local government. The umbrella group for Scotland's local authorities, COSLA, have praised the bill, stating it will bring Scotland up to speed with other major countries in Europe. They also said it would have a positive impact on their members, saying, and I quote, "It's key to building on local and Scottish Government's joint commitment to improve outcomes for our communities and renew democratic participation across Scotland." Enthusing people about the importance of local democracy is key to all of this. In the most recent council elections in 2017, voter turnout was just 47%. Most people stayed at home than went to the polling station, and in some areas that figure was as low as 39%. Perhaps if the voters had faith that the people they elected locally had more influence on the decisions which impacted their lives, those disappointing statistics would soon improve. Presiding Officer, for too long, devolution has come into the Scottish Parliament without being pushed out the other side to those who need it most. The SNP government has grabbed powers from both sides and still wants more. Establishing a legal framework which prioritises the importance of community leadership and local accountability would at least begin to turn the tide on that worrying trend. People need to see a quality of decision making so they can have faith in the system from the borders to the Highlands and all the areas in between. Local councils are the ones who know their area and their people best. And as such, I will be supporting this bill at stage one this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harris. And I call David Torrance to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking my colleague Annie Whiteman for all his hard work on this bill. I served as a councillor on Fife Council in 1995 until I was elected as an MSP in 2011. Many of my fellow MSPs share this common experience of being elected as a local councillor and then later being elected as an MSP. Most of us who have that experience have seen the relationship between local government and the Scottish Government at first hand, and from both sides of the fence. We've seen the tensions which can arise within one political party is in government and the different political parties in control in the local authority. We have formed our own perceptions of the strengths and weaknesses of our current system of local government and of its relationship with central government as part of that. My constituency includes the town of Kirkcaldy, first mentioned in the town council there was around 1582. It became a royal borough in 1644 and has a very long tradition of local government. The town became part of Kirkcaldy District in 1975 as a result of local government reorganisation of the 1970s. And in 1996, Kirkcaldy District Council became part of Fife Council under the 1990s reorganisation. Ontarland is also my constituency. Its history of local government is even longer than Kirkcaldy. It became a royal borough in 1541. Its local government has shared the same fate as Kirkcaldy and shows the demise of local decision making. Local government does not stand still. It evolves over time. Part of that evolution is its relationship with central government. The bill has a European dimension. It concerns a European charter. Kirkcaldy, with a population of around 49,000, is twinned with Ingolstadt in Bavaria, which has a population of 127,000. Our respective civil leaders and community groups have been visiting each other since 1962, and Bunterland is twinned with Fletford in southwest Norway, which has a population of 9,000. The relationship is even older than that between Kirkcaldy and Ingolstadt, and it began in 1946. And clearly both show twin towns sit in a very different local government systems to Kirkcaldy and Bertelland. Such relationships remind us other places approach local government differently. We must always be asking ourselves if we can learn from others and so make improvements for ourselves. Having reviewed the evidence of a local government and communities committee, it seems that we are already bound to comply with charter as it is an international legal instrument, but no means exist to ensure that compliance. It is not part of our domestic law. The UK government expressed its support for a European charter by signing it in 2009, and as I understand, this bill will import it into Scots law so it has a direct effect. The Local Government and Communities Committee has seen submissions on this bill from a range of sources. These include a number of our local authorities, Faculty of Advocates, Law Society for Scotland and COSLA and Reform Scotland. The evidence submitted to the committee revealed to me that incorporation of a European charter into Scots law has long been argued for by COSLA. Further, COSLA was involved in drafting the European Charter back in the 1980s, and its 2014 Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy recommended incorporation in Scots law. Going beyond COSLA, legitimate interest in this matter, the Conservative Steering Group on the Scottish Parliament argued for incorporation of the European Charter in 1999 and expressed regret that it had not happened when it published its 20th anniversary report in 2019. In 2015, the UK All-Party Parliamentary Group on Reform, Decentralisation and Devolution commissioned an inquiry to look at how devolution across the whole of the United Kingdom could be better achieved. The group's final report recommended transposing the European Charter on local self-government into primary legislation. I was particularly encouraged by a local government, the committee's view as expressed in the Stage 1 report that it does not expect the bill to be disruptive, but it would act as a spur for local and central government to cooperate effectively to make better laws and policies and to avoid conflict. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, if the Scottish Parliament can enact legislation which will improve relationships between local government and the Scottish Government, in principle I am in favour of it, and I am pleased to note that the Scottish Government has expressed support for this bill. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Torrance. I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Rhoda Grant. Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And may I congratulate number one, pain in the whatever, Andy Whiteman. He is so to great and good effect in this particular case, as in so many others. As a former member of the Local Government Committee for 59 meetings, I fully appreciate the importance of this proposal. Bringing forward this legislation is an important step both for the Charter, but more importantly for Scotland. And it's one that would ensure that its maximum impact legislating does that. It takes us towards clarifying and improving the relationship between local and national government. It provides clarity on how local and national government should interact, their mutual responsibilities to each other. Terms of engagement underpinned by law are firm foundation for that interaction. And it removes ambiguity. It formalises the Scottish Government's commitment to local government, whatever the complexion of any future government. It starts to equalise the relationship between the two and provides for balance through a mediated legal process. Enhances understanding of the relationship and respective responsibilities, and I believe will encourage even greater operational efficiency in both. And just before going on, let's say for both parts of our government system in Scotland, the crisis over the last year has shown what we're capable of, and I hope that this further supports that and that local government is further strengthened. The quality of our democracy will improve with this, encouraging action taken locally. A greater access to decision making because there will be more of it that's local, and more people outside the directly elected group of people who run things or think they run things will be possible. Decision makers who are accessible make better decisions. That is democracy. Now, Scottish councillors probably represent more people on average than almost anywhere in Europe. Indeed, I know of one council seat, which if all the other seats were of the same area, would mean there would be a mere 12 councillors in the whole of Scotland. Some of these big seats are simply untenable. But this bill doesn't address that issue, and so it does not represent anything more than my view of something that we need to do another day, Presiding Officer, another day. A benefit of this proposed legislation is adaptability, placing clear parameters in the role of local and national government, responsibility in the hands of communities, empowerment in action, confidence to act. And that means local government will be even more prepared to apply solutions that are distinct to local strengths and challenges. There are some technical aspects, of course, and others have made reference. Law Society talks about the implementation period of 6 months being rather short, and I would suggest I agree with them. There are considerable changes for that kind of time scale. The second issue is whether a reporting cycle of 5 years is too long, and I suspect that is also true. So we need to look at these things, and that's what stage two and stage three is all about. But this bill fits with what we envisage we should see in local government. Now, let me just conclude, Presiding Officer, by deconstructing one canard that's run through too many contributions, that the SNP government is a centralising government. In 2007, when we came into power, we found we'd inherited from the Liberal Labour administration a situation that saw nearly one quarter of council pending ring-fenced. Within months, we reduced that to under 2%. Better research is required by colleagues on other benches. The robust interchange of political debate, that's fine, but let's make it based on facts. Presiding Officer, I'm happy to support this bill.
Thank you very much, Mr Stevenson. And can I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I speak in support of this bill. It seeks to incorporate the European Charter of Self-Government into Scots law, as others have said. The Charter was created in 1985 by the Council of Europe, setting out 10 principles to protect the basic powers of local authorities. The Charter advocates for the principle of subsidiarity, and local authorities should be able to regulate and manage public affairs under their own responsibility and interests of their local populations. And we have seen rampant centralisation and disempowerment of local authorities, and therefore they are in desperate need of this legislation. The Charter ensures that public responsibility should be exercised by the authorities closest to the people affected by them. A higher level of government should only be involved where it is impossible or less efficient to deliver a level at the level immediately below. If this bill passes, it would allow individuals and organisations to challenge Scottish Government in court if its laws or decisions are not compatible with the Charter. It's not surprising, therefore, that many local authorities support the bill. COVID support has highlighted to me the benefits of decision-making taking place at the most local level possible. Local authorities across the Highlands and Islands in many ways very different geographies and socio-economic pressures to those in the rest of Scotland. The Charter would strengthen their ability to have local solutions for local problems. When I contact councils with regard to delays in making COVID business support available, they tell me they are waiting for the criteria for distribution from the Scottish Government. It's simply wrong that the Scottish Government announce funds, build expectation, but fail our councils and those that need that support by being tardy with the criteria. That criteria should be set by the councils that know their own communities. There is also strong support from Orkney Islands Council and from Shetland Islands Council, who I'm sure hope that the Islands Bill would meet some of those aspirations. Unfortunately, we've seen very little that is tangible from that legislation. They know what is best for their communities and how to make the most of resources available to them in their own unique geographical context. Implementing the Charter would give greater independence to local authorities in their distribution of COVID-19 recovery grants and funding, targeting the businesses and communities that are in most need in their own areas. In ordinary times, it would give them flexibility to serve their community needs with funds that are available. Sadly, we see local government increasingly disempowered. Boundary Commission are looking to cut the number of councillors representing vast rural areas in Highland Council. It does nothing for local decision making, making the ability of constituents to be able to contact their councillors even more difficult. Implementing the Charter into Scots law would mark a new era of strong, effective and responsive local government that best serves every community, taking into account their own local authorities' particular economic, social and geographical needs. I will therefore be supporting the bill tonight.
Thank you very much, Ms Grant. And can I call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I also thank Andy Whiteman for bringing forward this Member's Bill. At its heart, this is about strengthening our democracy in every community right across Scotland, making it more effective, more accountable and more accessible to the people it serves. It incorporates the 11 articles of the European Charter of Local Self-Government into Scots law, which was ratified in the UK in 1998, and the principles are already adhered to by the Scottish Government. However, this bill is important. The committee agreed that passing the bill creates the opportunity and space for local and central government to recommit together to an effective, respectful and inclusive working partnership. The committee also agreed that the bill would rectify an anomaly. It would mean that Scotland would no longer be one of the last remaining jurisdictions in the continent of Europe not to have given the Charter direct legal standing in domestic law. Additionally, This bill will highlight that cooperation and collaboration between national and local government is paramount to a functioning democracy. And nowhere have we seen this more, nor has it been more essential than in the last year. The COVID-19 pandemic has required all government agencies and local authorities to work together in order to keep people safe and supported throughout Scotland. Every day we see council employees, NHS staff and a whole range of volunteers and third sector agencies providing support, whether it's to those shielding, to families of key workers, to those having to self-isolate, or to individuals suffering from COVID in hospital. All fantastic examples of people and organisations working in a collaborative way to deliver for the people of Scotland. If it wasn't for councils, they would not have got tens of millions of pounds of support to the many businesses forced to close due to the pandemic. As a new member of the Local Government Committee, I've not focused on the detail of this bill. I've tried to highlight the importance of the partnership that already exists between national and local government and why this partnership needs to be protected and supported. I believe that this bill, alongside the local governance review and the work associated with a new fiscal framework for local government, are the mechanisms to do that and to ensure that partnership is based on mutual respect. In the time I've left, I just wanted to point out that cooperative working between the government and councils is not new. The concordat between local government and the Scottish Government was signed back in 2008. This aimed to deliver benefits for the people of Scotland, support the Scottish Government in delivering its purpose, strategic objectives and national outcomes, plus empower local government and their partners to deliver on local priorities. The SNP Government has in more recent years committed to local decision making, as is demonstrated by ambitious legislation such as the Community Empowerment Act in 2015 and the Islands Act in 2018, which signalled a significant transfer of powers to communities across Scotland. Presiding Officer, I will be pleased to join with colleagues in supporting the general principles of this bill at decision time today. Working collaboratively with local government is and will always be a priority for myself, the SNP Government, and I hope all other parties in this chamber. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. MacDonald. And can I call Fulton MacGregor before we move to closing speech? Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As others have already said before me, the Scottish Government values the role of local government and is committed to supporting this bill. I'm not myself a member of this committee, but from what I can tell, there is clearly cross-party support and consensus. Presiding Officer, at this stage, I'll make a declaration of interest as a previous councillor in North Lanarkshire and as a registered social worker with the SSSC. The pandemic has again shown a light on the pivotal role in our communities of the council and council workers, from teachers, and as you'd expect me to say, to social workers and many others working throughout these challenging times, and often putting the needs of those they serve in their communities first and before their own. And there's also many other council workers who often feel forgotten about, like refuse collectors, crossing patrollers, workers in registry offices, and so many others that it would be difficult to say them all. There are also new roles in the council created through the response to the pandemic, including teams set up to administer the ever-expanding business grants and funding schemes. And I want to pay personal tribute to the team in North Lanarkshire who have worked tirelessly to support local businesses in my constituency, and of course extend that to all North Lanarkshire and other local government workers. Presiding Officer, back to the bill in front of us, I feel that by supporting the general principles of the European Charter of Local Self-Government, the committee recognises that the Charter guides good governance in relation to the local government sector and helps protect council status, resources and autonomy. Our local government sector in Scotland should feel empowered and able to carry out their duties effectively, and I believe that following the principles set out in the Charter is one way of helping to achieve this. Of course, developing and maintaining a close constructive partnership between central and local government has always been a key priority of this government, and this can be demonstrated through the budget process, where whatever your views on the settlement and where the budget is currently sitting, the Cabinet Secretary has quite clearly got an open door policy with Clausla and others. This bill will allow the opportunity to ensure that that culture of partnership and participation is enshrined into Scots law. The Scottish Government is committed to such local decision making and ambitious legislation
such as the Community Empowerment Act and the Islands Act, have already seen a radical transfer of powers to communities across Scotland. We all want a vibrant, inclusive democracy and support local self-determination. This bill is welcome as it will help create the conditions for further, more ambitious changes to how Scotland is governed. I think more communities have also been encouraged to use the Community Empowerment Act to run local resources. You know, we've all had queries as MSPs, like to run old sports pitches or accommodation. This can only be a good thing. And in North Lanarkshire, again, perhaps after a slow start in this area, there is more evidence of this happening now, with, for example, the Kirkshaws neighbourhood house in my constituency being one good example. And I also believe that local area partnerships could have more teeth, and I felt this even back in my time when I was a councillor as well. And councils like North Lanarkshire, for example, are in themselves massive institutions, and often people feel further, metaphorically speaking, from decision-making in the civic centre in Motherwell or whatever the area is for other councils, than they do from Edinburgh or sometimes even London. So I think we need to take that into account. And the local groups with councillors and stakeholders for a certain town or village, they're almost always a better place to make key decisions about our communities. And that is something that I think we all believe in. I also want to touch on a point that Alison had raised about planning applications. And as Minister, Kevin Stewart will know, I'm seeking a round table event for a number of communities in my constituency, mainly in the Gap, Closh and Steps areas that have been impacted in recent years by housing developments. In many of these cases, the local authority has rejected the application, which is later overturned. I think that by engaging local communities at an earlier and ongoing stage, we can work together to find the right balance between housing, infrastructure building and protecting green space. And I do know through the recent planning bill that a lot of work has been done in this area. And on that matter of green space, Presiding Officer, I would like to note that there are many great opportunities in our local communities to enhance outdoor space and positively impact communities, especially where there is perhaps deprivation. And one such example of this is the old Moulton Canal and Cote Bridge, tidied up during the lockdown by volunteers. It's crying out for joint up working from the Government, Council, Scottish Canals and others. Something, incidentally, that I've been working on through the formation of a stakeholder group, which I convene and has already had two meetings. Presiding Officer, that's just some thoughts in terms of my own constituency, but in conclusion, I'd like to say this government is committed to local decision making, as is demonstrated by ambitious legislation such as I've said, as the Community Empowerment Act and the Islands Scotland Act, which signalled a significant transfer of powers to communities across Scotland. And I support the general principles of the bill at stage one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. McGregor. And we move to closing speeches now. Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
This has been an important debate this afternoon. For me, it's vital that following this bill, we see the change that causeless political leadership has agreed we need on a cross-party basis. Now is the time to review how powers, responsibilities and resources are shared across national and local spheres of government and with communities. It will amuse my local colleagues when I tell them that Stuart Stevenson thinks that there's only 2% ring fencing in this year's budget. There can be no meaningful change without leadership and commitment to the three interlinked empowerments: community, functional and fiscal change. Developing of one without the other will lead to changes that are superficial. So how do you empower communities about service delivery if that isn't how national services are delivered locally? Something we discussed in the recent bill on period products, and how we need to give organisations locally financial flexibility to change how they deliver in line with local need. And it's important that this bill is not followed by piecemeal change, but real change right across the public sector in Scotland. Points that Rhoda Grant made about diversity of Scotland and the Highlands and Islands in particular, in terms of geography and socio-economic pressures, are vital. And the Charter would have the ability to strengthen local solutions for their local problems. There are key areas where we need to see a new respect for our councils, not the micromanagement we saw last summer when local authorities were having to make urgent decisions on the pandemic without any confidence about how the Scottish Government would deliver on consequentials. And indeed, in last week's budget, we saw our councils praised on the one hand, yet given an underfunded council tax offer on the other. So I want to give an example of how things need to change in day-to-day legislation. We debated the short-term Let's Control Areas order in our committee yesterday, but while it gives councils the opportunity to propose a short-term let control order the power to refuse or approve days with the minister. And we've now had a decade of cuts to local government budgets, and it's high time that our councils are given more powers. And a key part of delivering on short-term lets would be giving our councils the power to introduce a tourism levy, something I was working on in the last session of the Parliament. But to date, we've only had the consultation on the principle of a tourist levy from the government, and we're now going to have to wait until the next Parliament for action. The Charter says that local authorities shall be entitled to adequate financial resources of their own, of which they may dispose freely within the framework of their own powers. That councils' financial resources shall be commensurate with the responsibilities provided for by the Constitution and the law, and that they should be of sufficiently diverse and buoyant nature to enable them to keep as pace as far as practically possible with the real evolution of the cost of carrying out their tasks. And at least part of their financial resources must come from local taxes and charges, of which, within the limits of statute, they have the powers to determine the rate. And it makes it clear that while measures taken to correct the effect of unequal resources between councils are possible, they must not diminish the discretion local authorities may exercise within their own sphere of responsibility. So these principles are all important, and I hope that this bill will come back to us, that we'll be able to pass it at stage three in this Parliament, that it will provide a new parity, that the SNP government will change tack and retreat from the centralisation which has been a hallmark of their time in power. We need both a change in the culture and the delivery of respect on a day-to-day basis. Today, I hope we support this bill. It can deliver real change which will empower our local councils and the communities they serve. And I look forward to seeing that change being delivered. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Boyack. And I call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Ian Campbell. Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to be speaking in this debate today. And can I start by thanking the Local Government and Communities Committee for its work on this bill? They produced a first-class report. I'm only sorry I was not on the committee to be part of its consideration. As members know, I was a very enthusiastic member of the committee until fairly recently. I knew that Andy Whiteman's bill was coming up. Indeed, I was a supporter of the committee dealing with it in this session. Consider Andy Whiteman to be a friend. We've often been on the same page, though not always. He's been a strong advocate of local government, as have I, but he's gone further than me by introducing this bill. And I back the bill and I congratulate him for it. Essentially, about showing respect to local government, something that has been and is lacking in this country. The bill aims to strengthen the status and standing of local government by incorporating the European Charter into Scots law, and this includes by making it possible to challenge in the Scottish courts any executive action by Scottish ministers within devolved competence or any legislation that's within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament and is believed to be incompatible with the Charter articles. The bill does a number of things, but there are two which are really important. It places a duty on Scottish ministers to act compatibly with the Charter articles, and it also places a duty on Scottish ministers to promote self-government. Now, I think we could have quite a few debates in the years ahead over that last point, Presiding Officer. For example, how could you argue that you were promoting local self-government if you centralised powers? How would the current restrictions on civil liberties be compatible with that? How would year-on-year cuts to council budgets be compatible with that? We could have some fun here, and I hope I'm here to see it. Mr. Whiteman contends that Scotland is unusual in Europe in not having transposed the Charter into domestic law. One of the key questions for the committee was what would the impact of the bill be, and they struggled with this. In some ways it could be symbolic, but I don't think that would be the case. The Charter itself has a number of key principles, and they've been mentioned by some of the speakers today. There have been some very good contributions today, most notably by my friend Alexander Stewart, who gave a blistering argument in favour of respecting local government. Convener James Dornan gave a very considered speech on behalf of the committee. Aileen Campbell said the bill was about partnership, and that it will strengthen local democracy. Sarah Boyack told how councillors feel their autonomy is being chipped away at. Keith Brown, what's Keith Brown? David Torrance and others were better. Now the last word should go to Andy Whiteman himself, always a man of independent mind and now at peace with himself as a genuine independent. In his opening remarks today, he said, local authority standing and powers have been weakened. The bill aims to fix that, and that's why we support it. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. And I call the Minister, Eileen Campbell, before Andy Whiteman to close. Eileen Campbell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to all the members who have contributed during this debate. It's very clear that there is cross-party support for the bill, and members recognise and appreciate the unique role of local government in Scotland. As I've made clear in my contribution, it is a sphere of government that we do truly and sincerely value and respect. And James Dornan gave a really considered address, I believe, which reflected the deep engagement and time that the committee have applied to this bill, really investigating the practical impact and effect of it and the benefits that it can bring if it is passed. And on that, I was struck by John Finney's remarks about using this bill to create and to use this opportunity that it creates to ensure that there is a vibrant and confident local government. I agree with that aspiration, and we should all endeavour to ensure that that is the case, that that is the practical effect of the bill. And therefore, on that basis, I do not accept the narrative that some of the Conservative contributors made this afternoon, a party that, let's not forget, has pursued a damaging and politically motivated agenda of austerity that has negatively impacted on so many of those that are most vulnerable, and which flies in the face that somehow they are the defenders of communities in this country when it is national and local government that have had to mitigate and mop up so much of the mess that has been left by that Conservative government. Because the reality is that we do work collaboratively with COSLA and local authorities, and that unfortunately might not fit the narrative of some, and I concede that we must always do more. But the reason I explicitly in my opening remarks mentioned the National Performance Framework, the Local Governance Review, the Islands Bill, also mentioned by Gordon MacDonald, is because they do seek to pursue our ambitions on subsidiarity. They reflect our respect for local government, and because outcomes for our people are always better when we work with local government, when we work in partnership together. And Keith Brown, I believe, in his comments, is also right to point out the pivotal moment that the pandemic has brought. It has meant that local government and national government have had to roll up our sleeves, focus on what is needed to be done, and that has demanded deeper engagement and partnership. Some of that we simply do not want to lose as we emerge through the current pandemic. We want to keep and retain some of that culture and that practice that has shifted so considerably during the last 10 months. And it's for that reason that COSLA played a full role in the Social Renewal Advisory Board, which published its report recently. And that is because both local government and the Scottish Government know that regardless of whether you have councillor before your name or MSP after it, we are all there to serve our communities, to empower them, to make life better, to make life and society equal and fairer. That report and its calls for action comes 10 years after the Christie report and shows that despite the progress that has been made, there is much still to do to ensure that we can realise the ambitions that are set out in our National Performance Framework, that National Performance Framework that is jointly signed up to by local and national government, and ensuring that we can make our aspirations for our communities realisable and tangible and real. So the bill, along with our approaches to community wealth building and a wellbeing economy, helps, I hope, steer the country into a space that does respect localism and subsidiarity and signals a new chapter in a positive relationship with local government. So I'm pleased that the committee did not agree that local government in Scotland has been neglected under devolution, but I am conscious that they did agree that there was room for improvement in that relationship between Holyrood and local government. and I take the committee's views really seriously and broadly share their aspirations. And it's incumbent on us all in the Scottish Parliament to ensure a parity of esteem between the various spheres of government is entrenched in how we work. And as we move forward, the Parliament also has a collective responsibility now to listen, to work collaboratively and to empower local government. This government has demonstrated our commitment to the principle of the Charter, the strong partnership that exists between local and central government, and the collaborative work that takes place each and every day as we respond to this current crisis is testament to that. The passing of the bill puts the strength of that relationship onto a legal footing, one which I know my local government colleagues feel will create the conditions and the opportunity to really strengthen that relationship and engender a more inclusive working partnership. The real, deep, intense and positive relationship that central and local government has had during COVID has shown how important the strength of our existing relationship is and how together we were able to take the practical and swift decisions that were needed when they were needed. And we must learn lessons from our response to that pandemic and also, though, use Mr. Whiteman's bill not as a threat of legal action where we might disagree, but instead choose to view it as a springboard to continue meaningful dialogue, understanding of each other's point of view, and important continue in the essential collaborative work that improves the lives and outcomes of the people of Scotland. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we are pleased to signal our support to the principles at this stage of Mr. Whiteman's bill, but again want to underline our real appreciation of the huge work that Mr. Whiteman has put into getting us to this stage and the further dialogue that is created and enabled in this Parliament to think through what more we need to do to further empower local government and communities.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Minister, Cabinet Secretary. And can I call on Andy Whiteman to close our debate?
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And I just want to thank all members who have contributed to the debate. I welcome the widespread level of support and encouragement and the points that have been raised. I won't get drawn into some of the more political contributions, although it is notable that the Charter has been a political document. And I would gently point out to the Conservatives that Conservative governments from 1985 to 1997 refused to sign the Charter as they regarded it as an interference with the sovereignty of Parliament. But I know the Scottish Conservatives have moved on. They support local autonomy, and I much welcome that. I also note that the SNP White Paper and Independence advocated incorporation of a charter, and so we can do so now. Presiding Officer, most European countries do not need to do what I'm proposing to do in this bill, and that's either because they have constitutional protections for local government, such as in Germany, where Article 28 of the Constitution guarantees political and fiscal autonomy, or it's because they have a monist legal system, meaning that international law to which they are a signatory automatically becomes part of domestic law. But as a number of members have pointed out, the UK as a whole does indeed remain a very centralised state, and Scotland too has one of the most centralised and concentrated systems of local government. And in that regard, I was struck by the comment in oral evidence from Councillor Malcolm Bell, the leader of Shetland Islands Council, when he said, and I quote, "Scotland likes to think of itself as a very European nation, which is an aspiration I agree with. However, in terms of its centralisation habits, Scotland is a very British nation. I think that the adoption of this bill would go a long way towards changing that." End of quote. Now, a number of members have talked about the practical impact of this bill, and James Dornan, as convener of the Local Government Committee, talked about it as well. And I think it's important to stress that this is principally about a culture change. John Finney talked about heightened awareness, and it is an awareness of the fact that these charter articles are law that will hopefully improve policy making and dialogue between central and local government. Now, the bill, of course, will not in and of itself fix the various issues that members have with local government, but hopefully government will have to think carefully. For example, are we indeed compliant with Article 9.3 on financial resources? Now, the Council of Europe, of course, established no judicial oversight mechanism of the Charter, apart from monitoring missions to member states. And in 2014, the monitoring mission noted certainly a number of positives, but also noted, for example, a failure to comply with Article 2 on incorporation, which this bill addresses. Alexander Stewart talked about financial powers, and indeed that's one of the main political debates we have in Parliament about the powers of local government. And Article 9 and its various sub-articles address that quite well. The Faculty of Advocates noted issues with Article 4, and Alex Cole-Hamilton mentioned his former colleague Tavish Scott arguing for a power of general competence. Well, indeed, that is a legal obligation under Article 4.2. And Professor Hemsworth, in evidence, also told the committee that current arrangements over local taxation and rate-setting powers are, in his words, pretty precarious in terms of compliance with Article 9.3. Members have also hinted as well that the articles are drafted in very broad terms. The courts may have difficulty in interpreting these. And, of course, they were negotiated as very broad articles to be acceptable to 47 countries with very different constitutional and democratic traditions. And unlike the Charter's more famous cousin, the European Convention on Human Rights, which has a judicial mechanism built in, this does not. And there's been very little litigation across the Council of Europe on the Charter. But any dispute that will, no doubt, will arise in due course that does end up in the Scottish courts, they will have the task of doing what they do in day out, and that is interpreting statutes and interpreting the articles. And I'm confident that over time, the Scottish courts will have no problem in doing that. Now, Alison Harris, she mentioned low turnouts at elections. Indeed, across Europe, countries have turnouts as high as 80% in many cases. And where local government has power, people take note, they participate, and they benefit. David Torrance reminded us of the ancient history of local government, Kirkcaldy founded in 1582. I welcome Stuart Stevenson's backhanded compliment and commend him for his own acute and perceptive analysis. And Rhoda Grant was right to highlight the state of local government in the Highlands, Highland Council being a very, very large authority, but also having a very small authority in Orkney Islands Council as well. And Sarah Boyk, in closing, I think hinted that this is an opportunity for a reset in relationships. So in conclusion, presiding officer, members' bills do take quite a bit of effort, and I would like to thank, in closing, my staff, Charlotte Maddox and Gillian Mackay, for their hard work and support over the past 3 years. Presiding officer, in January 2020, the Parliament voted to fly the flag of the Council of Europe outside this chamber in recognition of the UK's continued membership of the Council and this Parliament's commitment to human rights, democracy and the rule of law. So let's vote tonight to deliver the aspirations of campaigners for devolution and to join the rest of Europe and incorporate this important treaty into Scots law. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wyman. And that concludes our debate on the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporation Scotland Bill at Stage 1. We're going to move, there's only one question, we move to decision time now. There's actually only the one question to be put as a result of today's business, which is on the bill. Now, when I'm going to put the question in a second. I'm conscious that we're voting online, so I'm going to actually presume agreement, and I only want you to put an N. In the chat box. I know that some members do support the bill, but I want to know if anybody doesn't support the bill, in which case I will have to run a vote. Okay? So, and I'm getting a point of order here before I even start. I'm getting a point of order from Edward Mountain. So, point of order, Edward Mountain, before I proceed.
Presiding officer, sorry, the point of order is I could not hear a word what you were saying because somebody was walking over your speech from the broadcasting. So, could I ask you to repeat that, please, so I can make sure we do the right thing?
Thank you very much, Mr. Mountain, for that, and happy to do so. The microphones came on here too, but I thought it was only briefly. So just to confirm, we're going to move to decision time. I'm going to put, there's only one vote to be put tonight, so I'm going to put the vote on the bill in the name of Andy Whiteman. But before I do put the question, I just want to ask members, don't indicate yes if you support. Just those who object to the bill, put an N in the chat box, because if, I'll be honest, if I see more than 100 yeses, I won't be able to find the noes. So the only indication you need to put is if you disagree to the question, if you say no. So the question is, that motion 23963 in the name of Andy Whiteman on the European Charter of Local Self-Government and Corporation Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. They just put an N in the chat box if you disagree. That's good. We are agreed. No disagreement, yes. We are agreed and the bill is passed at Stage 1. Thank you very much, colleagues. That concludes this item of business. I'm now going to pass on, we've got members' business, but before we do that, I'm going to pass on to my colleague, Linda Fabiani, who is going to take... Linda Fabiani.